Good afternoon, friends. Myself Vipul Chudasama from Nirma University. I am representing Nirma University, and for this 5 days workshop, I will explaining you about the what is the course structure and pattern for examination for our computer programming subject in at our university. The computer programming subject is compulsory for all branches. In Nirma University, there are different programs running. We call it the program, like the same IIT is going, that BTech program, MCA program, management program. Same way we have a different programs like for electronics communication, computer engineering, information technology. These are the programs. For all these branches, we have compulsory subject for computer programming. So all branches will study the computer programming subject in their semester 1, computer programming 1, semester 2, computer programming 2. Then the syllabus right now I am covering, that is only the part of that computer programming subject teaching by NIT department, means Institute of Technology. Under that all engineering branches will come. So here the computer, we have assigned a code name for that is 2C101, that is given to that, and this is a syllabus for computer programming 1. So here we include a teaching scheme also, that is 3 lectures we have to give, then 1 is a tutorial, then 2 hours for lab, and total credit is 5. So if student successfully complete, then he will earn the credit, all credit of 5. So 3 hours we have to give the lecture for per week, that, and we are dividing the whole class in a batch, 3 batches, that for each batch we are conducting the tutorial session. So in particular that total 4 hours we are giving. So it will cover this particular topics under that, then assignment and the tutorial we have to for this computer programming 1. See, these are the standard given to all the branches. It is freedom given to the particular teaching faculty that they can modify and give other also, but these are the basic that we are giving to the all the faculties. So based on the particular topic we are giving the tutorials. For example, is tutorial 2, that is containing that particular constant, variable and data type. So based on that we have a question number 1, that is a how you define the variable, the declaration of variable, then we are evaluating the student. The same way for managing input output, here expression, how to calculate the evaluation of expression, and then looping, branching, we are here explaining different types of loops, that decision statements are there, and what is the difference between that, or how you are giving the different output if you are looking the same type of loops also there. So this is a for computer programming 1. Now second semester that they are learning is computer programming 2. So we have same, the course code is that 2C102, and this is a syllabus for that. Now here also the pattern teaching scheme is like two hours per week we have to give the theory session, then 1 tutorial, 2 hours for lab, and credit is 4. We are covering this particular topics under that. First general concept, then programming language, syntax for that, and then tutorial again. So some outputs in tutorial that they have to cover. Next is this is a evaluation pattern for our syllabus. Okay, anyway, so this is a particular teaching scheme that I have explained, that for computer programming 1, that we have that credit 5, and then we have a examination scheme is also there. For we are taking 2 examination, one is mid semester exam, another is a semester end exam, that is 1 hour and 30 minutes, and on a semester end is 3 hours. The weightage we are giving, assigning the weightage to that particular exam. So from that the component weightage we calculate the final total of the student. The mid semester exam contains the 0.25 weightage, same way that semester exam 0.4, the term assignment will contain 0.15, and the lab will contain the 0.28. So actually that breakup is like this. So whatever term assignment, that is that we will assign, so this is a particular assignment weightage. We are giving the 5 assignment, each containing 10 marks. So we will calculate the that component for giving the marks out of 50, then we will take the component of that 0.5. Same way for tutorial, that is 0.25, we will give a 5 tutorial, then each of 10 marks, and then class test. So we will taking a 2 class test, then it having 0.25. So this total will make 100. From that we are taking a component of that 0.15. So this is a 50, 25, 25, it makes total 100, and then its overall component is 15% out of 100. Same way for lab practical, we have particular 10 practical we are giving to the students. We will each practical contains 10 marks, then we will find out the total of that out of 100, and then we have a viva sort of and final examination, in that contains 0.25, that is contained 25 marks. So that is total is 100. Again we are taking the from this 100 we are taking the 20%. Why? Because it is in a given that examination scheme is 0.2, so total is 35% of TA plus lab, term assignment, class test and lab. Then mid semester exam, same, that is 50 marks, 0.25 marks we are having, so 25. If student cannot clear the mid semester exam, then he has to appear for block exam. So where the 75% syllabus was there, and that block exam also carries the 50 marks, the same scheme also, that having 25% weightage. So it is again 25. Then semester end, 100 marks question paper is there, 3 hours exam is there, so 40% weightage is there. So total from that is 35 plus 25 and 40, that is total 100. So from student is getting from that 100 marks. Now here, if student cannot clear a semester end exam, we have another exam that is called supplementary exam. That is a one attempt there, after that exam is semester exam is over, after 1 month we have kept for that supplementary exam, and if student clear that, he will appear to for next semester exam. Then sample question for, I have taken that. So this is a sample question paper for computer programming for all branches. Here we for divided in, this is a particular mid semester exam paper, and we are dividing that into 3 questions, like for 18 marks, 16 marks, and 25% is a total out of 50, 25% is a optional student. Now first question contains true false justification, then finding the second question will finding the outputs, correct the outputs, and if in programming any errors, this where is the error that there to mention, and based on that we will assign the marks for that. Then third question contains the writing the programs and theory. So more weightage is given for the programming in this, not based on theory. Here is the same as for CP2, showing the errors if any, give the possible outputs. Then semester end, semester end exam having a total 6 question. Generally it is divided into 2 sections. So it is that 50 marks from section 1, 50 marks for section 2. So like this is a computer programming one, all branches, section 1 alternative, then this is a particular program for that, question 3, then section 2 outputs, programs, comparison and all. Then this is a lab assignments for computer programming one. Again it is a based on that particular module that we are kept in a lesson planning also, that is first is getting acquired with the environment of C, and then boolean C, we are using boolean C for C programming and C++ programming. So the IDE introduction for first, and then rest of the data representation, then what is the constant variable, based on that exercise we are giving, then particular output pattern, there will have a concept of loops and that, then binary to decimal, decimal to binary, array, calculate, sorting a number particular, calculating harmonics, then functions, then structure, union and files and dynamic memory. So this is the 10 practicals we are giving. Same way for CP2, getting acquired with C in, C out, that they have to print something, then they have to give the grade. CP2 subject, when students are studying the CP2 subject, they have a background of C programming because that is a first semester subject. So definitely they don't have a much time, means it will not difficult for them to write the programming directly in C++. The logic is clear in C programming, so that are very familiar with that particular environment, Boolean ID environment and all. So they are very good for writing this particular programs that contains the, this is a string, constructor, destructor, friend function, operator overloading, inheritance, polymorphism, virtual functions, file management. In lab infrastructure, we have that particular type of 16 server, 368 systems available, list of softwares available, and every student having its own personal computer provided so that you can do easily the programming. Now, for specially first year student, we have a particular this labs allocated to that. Total number of systems are there, working hours are there, and net facility is also given to the student in extra timing so that they can utilize that. That's all. Thank you.
The second question is a slightly ticklish question, and this is for all of you. Because the earlier speaker mentioned use of Turbo C, you use Borland C. Now, one of the reasons why we are using Ubuntu and G++ is, apart from C++ being adhering to ANSI standard, if you so wish, and is a far superior compiler, it is also open source. Now, do you guarantee, absolutely guarantee, that every piece of software running on every PC of your lab is properly licensed and license record are maintained? Every piece.
So some software we have license, but for every PC I cannot say that.
No, that is because this is something which is utterly important for the society.
Yes.
Because what happens is our students think ki aisa chalta hai because teachers are doing it. And please note that teachers might be doing it inadvertently because they have no choice. But the college administration is primarily responsible.
Yeah.
We as teachers are responsible for bringing this issue up to the administration. I'll tell you, one of the problems is many of us teachers do not specifically bring it to the notice of the principal or director that these pieces of software are unlicensed and they must be licensed. There are less than 1% institutions in the country today which can claim to have licensed software. In my own department, if a student uploads any software on his or her PC which is unlicensed, the student is deregistered from the entire lab for a minimum period of 7 days. That's a punishment. Now, this kind of rigorous ethics, if we do not follow, then how do we expect our 1,000 teachers to even think about following it? And how do we expect 6 lakh students to even imagine following such ethics? I believe that is far more important question than the entire knowledge of programming. And we have not yet answered this question affirmatively. As a part of the discussion on this, I would like you to seriously consider this and resolve something. There has to be a nationwide movement. You know, we talk of corruption. In this sense, in terms of intellectual property respect, we represent the most corrupt part of the Indian population. And we are not willing to admit that we are doing corruption. Now, this may sound harsh, but we had a problem about 20 years ago. I paid 36 lakh rupees when I was Dean of Resources to Microsoft to get a site license for the institute. You know why? Not because we are using Microsoft unlicensed software in the labs, but because in the hostel, students were using Microsoft software.
Students are taking.
And we consider ourselves to be responsible because we are a residential institution. So we have, for example, license for Microsoft operating system, license for whatever we require. Now this, even at the cost of money, this policy should be followed, is unfortunately not true. My request to you is to consider the following resolution, that this group of coordinators considers it mandatory that any teacher attending this IST program should also undertake to do so at one's own institution. We have no mandate for rest of the world and rest of the courses. But as far as computer programming is concerned, any material that is released under this and any software on which it is used should be either licensed or open source.
But if the student is using licensed
software, we just paying Microsoft for the license, period. We have a site license.
So we have also college that.
Yeah, we also have license this one, but how you are checking whether that particular student is using unauthorized software?
No, there is no unauthorized software. Any software that is used is authorized. I paid huge lump sum amount of money and I pay it annually. That is what is called site license.
Yeah.
I don't have license in terms of number of users.
Okay.
I have unlimited license. I have specially negotiated it over 2 weeks' time. But if you notice in IIT Bombay, increasingly people will use Linux, people will use OpenOffice. I have Microsoft, by the way, Microsoft Office is not included in the site license. Microsoft Office has to be purchased. And the fact that people generally use licensed software is seen by the fact that students purchase this software. At the special price, it is available on IIT.
IIT having freedom for using what kind of this one OS we can use, but we don't have such a freedom because.
Of course, you have. You want to teach C programming.
Yeah.
It does not say C programming must be taught using turbo compiler.
So we have that thing because if we consider.
Then get it removed. Have you ever raised your voice against that? It can be removed in 15 days if you fight.
Okay.
The point is, we don't fight. We accept that this definitely. Is the given thing. Now suppose you start the fight, suppose it does not work out in 15 days,
okay.
Can we not say that by July 2010,
okay.
Either if university says this shall be the syllabus, then university will pay every college for every license that is required for turbos. Otherwise, what right does university have to say you must use this?
They are going to say you purchase it.
No, so we are saying that instead of saying that, permit us to use this or that. We guarantee that C programmers coming out of our institution will be no less good than C programmers coming out of any other institution. Yeah, what is the purpose? The purpose is to use Turbo C or Borland C or Microsoft Office, or the purpose is to learn C programming, C++ programming. Take databases, for example.
Yeah.
I have seen people downloading what you call evaluation version of Oracle and using it as license. Why not use MySQL or PostgreSQL? Now, I will tell you, we can fight with university, we can argue with anybody. I think the trouble is with us. We are not convinced, first of all, that it's a criminal offense to use unlicensed. And if we are not convinced, to tell our students is very difficult. Now, how do we take this across to all teachers of the country? Otherwise, I tell you, there cannot be any progress without progress of basic ethics in life, technical or education. So this is something which hurts most of us very stupendously. So you'll find you have been given these laptops. The software cost running on the laptop is zero.
Definitely.
And I bet whatever you can do with any licensed software, I can do on this netbook exactly in the same way, perhaps better.
Yeah.
Now this is a mindset issue. And we talk about university, you know, university has said this.
Yeah.
Who frames the university syllabus? People like you and me.
Yeah.
So why are we not talking to people like you and me? How many times have we made representation to people like you and me at various university bodies saying, please take cognizance of this important fact? We have never done that. In writing, we have never objected.
Sir, myself conducted the university syllabus framing workshop in my college. That time I found that whatever elder professors are there, they are not ready to change the syllabus. For example, business application, they are saying, no, business application is okay. But I forcefully said that no, Linux is essential for MCM students, so make it compulsory for all the students. So right now for MCM, Linux is compulsory for third semester.
I think the point is much wider. What you are talking about is educating students on open source software. I think that is incidental. I am talking about the management of the institutions for which teachers are directly responsible. It might be done by directors, it might be done by anybody, but if you are teaching the course, everyone will say, who is running the lab? You are running the lab. Who is responsible for what runs there? You.
Yeah.
सामने आप दिखते हैं, बाद में जाके जूते आपको पड़ेंगे, लोगों को नहीं पड़ेंगे. नाउ दिस इज एंड वर्स्ट थिंग इज स्टूडेंट्स जेन्युइनली बिलीव कि मास्टर करता है तो मेरे को क्या प्रॉब्लम. नाउ हाउ डू वी, आई एम सॉरी टू इलॉन्गेट दिस डिस्कशन, बट आई वुड लाइक अ वेरी अनइक्विवोकल कमिटमेंट. एंड इफ ऑल द कोऑर्डिनेटर्स डू नॉट एग्री, देन एट ईच ऑफ योर प्लेसेस व्हेन 40 टीचर्स विल कलेक्ट टुगेदर, दे विल ऑल्सो नॉट एग्री.
Is it possible to send any kind of circular to all the universities?
No, it is very simple. As far as this course is concerned, you will not run it on any environment other than the one which is supplied from here. That is why in this coordinator's workshop, you are being given installation desk. Last 2 days, you will actually be installing this software on PCs. You will actually be doing it. Our people have slogged to make those CDs. And you will be carrying these CDs back. And one of the commitments required is for the duration of this workshop, the 25, 30, 40, 50 PCs that you make available for the trainers, they will all have this software installed. If you have Microsoft software, there is no harm. You can make that machine dual boot as many of us do. Most of your machines here are dual boot. All that we say is as far as this course is concerned, the Ubuntu partition of the boot shall only be used, nothing else. So we don't want to interfere in the management of the other institutions, but this is our way of suggesting that maybe you can look at this. But as far as this course is concerned, it will use C++ compiler, it will use gedit, it will use whatever the graphics package that comes in open source so that it is formally licensed, etc. Sorry, you are saying
NBA committee, I think they verify the license also, I think.
Who?
NBA accreditation committee.
NBA.
National Board of Accreditation.
That one which came out of the AICT.
Ah, yes.
Well, all those institutions are going down the drain. So I do not know how long that NBA will survive. But suppose the NBA comes here today, and today I have all licensed software. And tomorrow when they go back, I have something else. I have seen about 20, 15 years ago, I gave up being on these AICT committees because I have seen in a single week, meeting the same person who claimed 5 days ago to be a permanent faculty member of another institution, showing up in this institute and showing up this thing. I have seen same books in the library, physically same books in the library, which I had seen somewhere earlier. Well, you had to open it up to see the stamp. They were very careful in not putting anything on top. And that is what raised my suspicion. Any book in the library will have some stamp or something pasted on top of the book, right? Not inside the book. Anyway, but this is sad, let's not digress from this. But this is okay then, that we will take this up. But what I'm urging you to do is, go back and seriously start fighting against this. You don't have to fight for change, you have to fight for legality. So ask your management that I have 100 PCs in my lab, these will require this much software, your syllabus specifies this, either you give me licensed software or my lab shall not run from 1st January. As simple as that. If we are willing to go on strike for salaries, I think this is a much better cause to go on strike for.
Sir, can I add a point?
Yeah, please.
Sir, actually what we did, I'm David from Sona College of Technology. I am one of the person promoting open source software in our college. Last 3 years, I nearly fighted for open source to implement in our college. Last year, the entire first year student, they're using C program, compiling in GCC compiler. For our office automation, they are using OpenOffice in Fedora.
Okay.
This we implemented in last year.
So all your labs have this?
Yes. It is possible, 100% possible. Now also it is running like that only.
Oh, it has been possible for many years. People are discovering that now.
Yes.
Well, I am very happy. But here is an example.
Yes,
Sona is not one of the regional engineering colleges or big places. But they can do it out of sheer conviction themselves. And they can get it implemented themselves. So I think anybody can do it.
I think before 3 years, the committee formed NRC FOSS, initiated by Mr. Dr. Krishnan.
I know.
I am one of the staff member in that time that trained us.
Oh, there.
Yes.
Krishnan has been another visionary.
Yes.
I'm trying to get him involved in some of our efforts here. But Tamil Nadu is one state. There is another state, West Bengal Technical University. They have adopted this in large measure. The point is very simple. In any syllabus, you should talk about what knowledge should be gained. why should we necessarily talk about the environment and tools that must be used? I mean, that question we have not asked.